Good evening, parents and dear students. Am I audible and visible?
Yes, ma'am. Good evening.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you so much. Yes. So, warm welcome from Vikalp Academy team. The purpose of the webinar is to give you an overview about management as a career and how to prepare for top B schools. As our guest, Anusha Soni, from IIM Indore will be joining us very soon. So let me just introduce you about Vikalp Academy. We have started with Vikalp Education with a very clear vision to develop the aptitude of the student. Vikalp Education was established in 2013, and so far we are associated with more than 100 institutes in Mumbai, Nagpur, Wardha, Bhandara, Chindwara, and Central India. We have classroom program in Nagpur, where we have two centers, Ramnagar and Nandanwan. So far, we have trained more than 25,000 students for aptitude enhancement, for campus recruitment training, for CAT preparation, and for other MBA entrances. Apart from that, Vikalp Academy is a part of Vikalp Education, and we are training students from after 12th, law entrance, and management. We have a team of professionals with affiliate corporate experience as well as academic background. We also have 30 plus corporate expertise. Those are associated with us for management development program. Okay, so Anusha Soni is already here, but I'll take just 5 minutes to give you a quick overview about how we can help you in your preparation. Okay, so most of you might have just completed your 10th standard and you have moved to 11th. So this is something which is always a dilemma in our mind, that which career option to go for. Okay, so it is all about your interest, your ability, and the career options that you are choosing. For that, there are a lot of psychometric tests which are available, and you might have gone through it. We also provide a psychometric test, that is MBTI. I myself is a psychometric trainer. I have done my diploma from Tata Institute of Social Science for MBTI. Okay, so in case if you need assistance for this also, we are happy to help you. Okay, so these are few top colleges which comes under management. So I am Indore, Rohtak, Symbiosis, Narsimunji, St. Xavier's, this all we are going to talk in detail once Anusha Soni ma'am will join with us. Then these are few entrances. IPM, Symbiosis ka it is set, and for Narsimunji we have NPAT, and it is also called as NMAT-C. So these are few B schools from where we can do our BBA, MBA integrated program, or just BBA. So to name them few, as I have already mentioned, I am Indore, I am Rohtak, Symbiosis, Narsimunji, Nirmay University, Christ University, Xavier's, St. Xavier's College. So Xavier's Institute is from Bhubaneswar. Even they are providing MBA preparation. Like for MBA, if you have to go for, you have to write ZAT. Then St. Xavier's is there from Mumbai. OP Jindal University is also there, University of Delhi, and Indraprastha Universities. So this is a brief about Symbiosis, like the paper pattern and how many centers are there. So this we can discuss at the time of counseling. We are certainly going to discuss in detail. Now this is about NPAT for Narsimunji. For Narsimunji, so far the criteria which is there is that you have to take mathematics in your 12th standard. So in 2021 or 2022, the notifications will be will like give you a clear idea. Now this is a preparation strategy which Vikalp provides. The first part is aptitude, that is numerical ability, logical and verbal ability, which is these are the sections which are there in almost all the entrances. Now the extra that we are doing with our students is we are developing the reading skills of the student, because it is very important if you are going to get into management as a career, reading is something that you have to do it. So on a regular basis, we are doing book reviews. We are discussing the editorials from the Hindu and Indian Express in our classroom. We are also suggesting students to read magazines, and the discussion on magazines are also being done. To upgrade the knowledge, because knowledge upgradation is simultaneously important. It's not about just a preparation for an entrance. We also have to look at on a broader perspective, because there are other processes also, like written ability test, group discussion, personal interview. So for that, we are preparing you for the knowledge upgradation, where we are doing current affairs on a weekly and monthly basis. We are taking debates in the class. We are also doing group discussions. Now, performance check really matters, because until unless you are not being checked on a regular basis, it becomes difficult for you to understand at what level you are and how much we have to scale up. So personality analysis is one part, psychometric that I have told you. The next is topic test. As and when we complete a particular topic, we take a topic test and we make it very clear to the students at what level the student is and how to improve. Then quizzes is there, which makes the class interesting. And again, it gives you a lot of knowledge. Case study, as when we are going for management, case study is something which is really important. So we are going to take the cases in the class and let's understand, and we try to make the students understand that how we can deal with the cases and how we can improve our analytical thinking. Now, the next is the final lab. And in this, we are providing crash course of nearly 45 to 55 days, where every day we are conducting classes for 4 to 6 hours. We are also going to provide workshops on the advanced topics. Then exam strategies are being discussed, because you may be failing more than one or two entrances. So how to deal with the different examination. And the last, which is very important portion of your preparation, is mocks with its analysis. Because without analysis, just giving mock is not going to improve your score. So these are a few exclusive features of Vikalp. On your left hand side, you can quickly read it. These are few snapshots which have been taken from our classroom. So we are conducting the Hindu review. We are taking sessions on aptitude. Now this is our course curriculum for 2 years foundation. We are providing 500 plus hours of classroom as well as online preparation. Material will be provided to you. Online tests will be provided to you. And there will be take home tests as well. So similarly, we have a pattern for 1 year, and we have for crash course also. So this is our team, which is our strength. So Rishi Chaurasia, who just discussed with you, sir is having more than 15 years of experience, and sir is a quant trainer, as well as he will be helping you in your current affairs. I myself, Shweta Bhandari, I am a verbal trainer, and I'll be a mentor and a center manager at Ramnagar. We have Praveen Vankhede, sir. He is an engineer from VNIT. He also takes care of quantitative ability. We have Amitava Basak, sir. He is having more than 15 years of experience in corporate, and he is associated with us for verbal, and most importantly, the motivational part, which is really required in your entrance. We also have Ritesh, sir, who is an engineer, and he will be taking the higher mathematics, the quantitative part. We have Shubham Dwivedi, sir. He will be associated with us for current affairs and static GK. Now, few of our mentors who will be visiting Nagpur on and off to guide our students. So we have Suji, sir. He is a banker basically, and he deals with basic, he deals with advanced mathematics and quantitative. We have Vikrant, sir. He is having more than 18 years of experience. He is expertise in written ability test and group discussion and personal interview, which is obviously a next level once you clear the aptitude. Then we also have Ratnabha, sir. He's also having more than 18 years of experience, and he's expertise into reading comprehension and vocabulary. We have Manoj Sehgal, sir. So last week, we have conducted session with Manoj, sir, regarding the BBA entrances. So he's having 24 years of experience. He deals in quantitative and LRDI. We have Akash sir. He's specialized in critical reasoning. We also have Ruchi ma'am. She is basically having more than 12 years of experience into verbal ability and reading comprehension. And she takes book reviews at our institute. So there are a few other options with you when you are preparing after, let's say, 10th standard. So law could be another prominent option that you can look for. And we at Vikalp, we provide training for law entrance also. So these are few results of last year. Then we also train students for hotel management. So under Vikalp Academy, we are training students for ITM, for BBA entrance, for law entrance, and for hotel management. So that's all from my end. We are also providing online counseling because due to COVID, it becomes really difficult to visit the center. So we are taking online counseling where we can just sit in front of each other on screen. Okay, so this is another facility that we are providing. And right now we are running online classes. So in detail, we can discuss, of course, after the session. So Anusha ma'am, are you there?
Yes ma'am, I'm here.
Okay, so just to give you a brief introduction about Anusha ma'am. Anusha Soni, she's from IIM Indore. She's a final year MBA student. And she's in her final year IPM. She's a former president of IPM Media and PR Committee. She also wrote her ALIT, that is a law entrance for NLU Delhi. And she secured All India Rank 36. So we welcome you, Anusha, on behalf of Vikalp Academy. Please guide our students.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the welcome, ma'am. I see we have around 33 participants with us right now. Although I've prepared a PPT and sort of put a lot of text there, I would prefer if this is a very interactive session and not a monologue. And instead of that, any questions or doubts, please feel free to unmute yourselves and ask your doubts then and there. Because this is, even though it looks like a very formal session, I would appreciate if it's pretty much on the informal end. Is my screen visible to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. So I'll just start with the basics of IPM. I'm assuming that a lot of you are not extremely sure of what IPM is exactly, even though you, am I audible properly?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I think it should be better now. So as Shweta ma'am also said in her introduction that there are a lot of options for colleges in a BBA program. And so there are a lot of private colleges also. But just one thing here that about IPM specifically, I think I am Rohtak offers BBA, but I am Indore's, I am Indore offers foundations. So the curriculum, the moment someone says BBA, it's like the curriculum is, the notion of the curriculum is completely different. While BA foundations in management studies, the subjects are really different. So just to begin with, the first clarity you should have about IPM, especially with foundations in management studies. Is it clear now? Hello? Is the audio fine? Hello? Hello?
Yes, Anusha, okay. It is fine. You can go ahead.
Okay, I just got a couple of messages. Actually, it suddenly started raining here, so the network is pretty bad right now. Anyway, moving ahead. So yeah, that's the first thing you have to be clear with, that it's not a bachelor's in business administration. It's a BA Foundations in Management Studies. So the one that is offered at IIM Indore, as the same as IIM Rohtak, is a five-year program. The first 3 years are basically aiming to construct individuals into people who are better equipped as managers, who have more foundational, who have a better strong foundations for management, who can actually leverage their MBA studies. So the first 3 years are not a technical specialization as such, but are a lot of other general you learn in MBA better. So I'll elaborate on the subjects in the later slides. So again, as I mentioned, the first 3 years involve a combination of analytical rigor and wide exposure. So why do I say analytical rigor is because the subjects that are taught are pretty demanding. And there is this very conventional notion that if you're doing something like BBA or basically anything that's not science, it would, especially in IPM, that's really not the case. So we have pretty heavy statistics and economics courses in the first 3 years. And by pretty heavy, I mean really heavy courses. So it's not like it's just because it's not BTech or not anything related to science, it's easier, it's not as academically demanding. So I'll also list down, I'll also tell you a couple of subjects that we have, but just to give you an overview, the subjects are really academically demanding because it gets very competitive after a point in time. So this is just to clarify that if you think that I'm never, not just for IPM, but for any field in general, never opt for it just because you think that it would be easier than the other options that I have. For example, I had a lot of other people preparing for IPM with me or who had taken commerce because they thought that it would be easier than science and their undergraduate studies after that would be easier than science, which is not of before even thinking about IPM, that this is going to be an easier path than a BTech or a BSc or any other technical field. Having said that, if you're in the program, if you get selected in the program, that's one thing that you all select, which means that you can sail through the course, and if you can grasp the subjects properly, you surely have a great learning out of them. And being someone who has almost completed the course now, I can easily say that if it weren't for this course, I wouldn't have known so many things that I did. So as I was saying, there are three core foundational subjects that we are taught. First, economics, second, maths and statistics, and third, humanities. Now, one natural thought that anyone has while going for something that they think is BBA is that they're getting rid of maths finally. And that's also the motivation for a lot of people to not go for other entrance exams and to choose IPM instead. But especially in the first year of IPM, there's some really rigorous mathematics that's taught. So we have 6 credit courses on differential calculus specifically, then we have integral calculus. So there are very specific mathematics courses and very, very specific statistics courses, going from economics, statistics, to a lot of core economics courses like microeconomics, macroeconomics, game theory. So a lot of demanding subjects, but a lot of subjects that also add immense value to anyone as an individual. I've never been a fan of studying a lot of maths. I was good in it, but I never really thought that I'm studying something useful. But having said that, the courses that are taught in IPM, I really found them to be practical. Something like game theory, where you have a lot of real life simulations of how you do things when the other one is doing this. So a lot of those subjects are pretty practical and useful lessons for any individual, especially managers. Then talking about humanities also a lot of courses ranging from psychology, sociology, political science. So all of these courses, no matter how technically proficient you are or how well educated you are, if you do not have an understanding of what's going around and how things work around you, I think this is one of the biggest edge that IPM gives a student, is that
it basically prepares you to not only grasp information from the surroundings, but also to have a perspective on things. Now, right now, when I talk to people, when I talk to my batchmates who had chosen other fields, I feel that this is one of the best things that IPM has taught me to do, that it has given me the ability to perceive things differently. And that's really one of the things that makes you stand apart from the crowd. Going to the next slide, sir. Yeah. So why IPM? I don't think there is any one answer fits all for this question. But overall, if you're someone who feels like all the other courses that are there are not something that he or she would find a fit in, and you find yourself a misfit everywhere else, then maybe IPM is the course for you, because I have honestly never seen any other course offering a mix like this course. So in my 12th standard, when I was preparing for CLAT and ALIT, I never thought that there would be an undergrad course that would teach you heavy calculus while giving you a lot of lessons in psychology, while also training you in French language, while also giving you a lot of dance lessons ranging from salsa to Kathak. So, you know, that is the variety of the course. That is the variety of the subjects offered in IPM. And in this topic specifically, why IPM, I'm assuming that some of you are preparing for competitive exams in general and not just IPM. Just like I did, I was preparing for CLAT and ALIT. And as Shweta ma'am mentioned, I got through NLUD, but I dropped NLUD. So why IPM? I'll just tell you why I chose IPM and why I didn't go for NLUD after having taken admission in that college. And that's specifically and precisely because I just found this course to be more like me. Like I fit myself, I would fit myself here better. And that's because I have always been a person who has liked to do a lot of different things. So just because I am from IPM, I wouldn't like to say that IPM is the best course for anyone. But I would want to tell you my reasons for choosing IPM, and if that goes well with you, probably that's also the course for you. So I'm a person who always liked to do a lot of things. I was doing good academically in school, but I was never the person who was only into academics. I also like to do a lot of other co-curricular, extracurricular activities. And that's exactly what IPM gives you the freedom to do. It lets you explore a lot of things before actually deciding that, okay, this is what I'm going to do in my life ahead. Because I honestly feel as a 12th standard student, or even after like a couple of years after that, you do not really know enough to decide with utmost certainty that, okay, this is what I'm going to do with my life. So one of the major advantages of IPM is that it gives you the space to explore a lot of different things, to try out what you want to do in life, to try out a lot of new things that you probably haven't done in school. And that's when you realize that, okay, I think I'm sort of inclined in this field. So for example, when I was studying undergrad in IPM, I realized that I had never studied psychology before that. And I realized that, okay, this is something that really interests me. I would want to explore something similar. And when you come to MBA, all of these core subjects really help you out. Like now I realize how much marketing is dependent on psychology. So how much the core foundational study of psychology has helped me in my marketing specialization. So similarly, a lot of economics and statistics study are actually the grounds of core finance. So all of the MBA subjects that we're studying right now have a lot to do with the grounds that we made in IPM. Also, as I mentioned about the variety, I have a lot of seniors who are doing a lot of different things right now. Like, for example, one of my seniors is pursuing a post-graduation in fashion designing from Italy. One of them is an entrepreneur. One of them is at a very good position in corporate. one of them has joined the government in some role. So that's the kind of space that you get to explore things, and you get and you come to know of a lot of things that you can do. So that's again at the cost of sounding repetitive. That's the kind of space you need as an undergraduate student to try out different things without the pressure of having a certain career at your future site. Thank you so much, Anushka. Next slide, sir, please. Yeah, coming from going from the variety of subjects to social internship point. Now, why IPM is different? There might be a course in, apart from the variety of subjects, there are a lot of add-ons, I would say, that IPM offers that I'm not sure whether a lot of other undergraduate courses offer as a part of their course design. There's, of course, you have the option of doing internships as and when you want to, but whether it's integrated into the course design as such, I'm not sure of that. So in IPM specifically, at the end of second year, IPM students are required to complete a social internship. So the goal, the motto of IIM Indore is to make socially conscious managers who are contextually relevant. Basically, just to put it in layman language, who are more aware and sensitive of whatever is happening around them. And I think social internship is one of the most important pillars of this grooming. So what exactly happens in social internship is that students, there's a proper placement process that happens, just like placement processes happens after MBA for actual corporate jobs. There's a proper placement process that happens for social internship, wherein a lot of companies, like the companies that are mentioned here, a lot of companies and NGOs come to the campus to take in interns for their CSR wings or their social causes. So we have had a couple of good companies like Akshay Patra Foundation, HCL, Institute of Peace and Conflict Studies, UNICEF. So all of these organizations take in interns who actually go there, apply whatever they've learned in IPM. And since one of the biggest cons that people talk of the course is that you don't have any work ex before doing your MBA. So since we are freshers and we don't really have an industry exposure, which I'll also talk about later, this really helps in not only getting to know how organizations actually function, but also, you know, sort of getting more socially conscious, as the institute puts it, to get to know what are the things going around in the world so that we just don't end up being the regular corporate slaves and add more value than just being a corporate slave. Next slide, sir, please. Yeah, talking about another add-on, yes, these are all of my photos, foreign exchange program. So I think the best part of my entire IPM undergrad years was the foreign exchange program. Not just because we fancy being in a foreign country and, you know, traveling across the world, but because of the amount of learning that I never thought just going out to the country can give me. So again, at undergraduate level, there are not a lot of good colleges that offer a foreign exchange program at some of the best B schools across the nation. So I was studying at EM Lyon for 5 months, which is one of the best B schools across the world. It is ranked 35th overall. And the kind of education there, no matter how much you say that Indian education is best, which I still agree it is, but the kind of exposure you get by merely sitting in a class which has students from, say, 20 different nationalities, the kind of opinions you get about the kind of opinions they have about different countries, different kind of people, the kind of exposure you get, you just change a lot as a person because you know so much more. And not just knowing so much more, I think you get to realize that there's so much that you don't know. So you become a lot more humble as a person because you just exposed to this huge, huge side that you're unaware of. You're still unaware of that, but you're still, but you're at least aware that this is something that I don't know. So that humbles you as an individual a lot. Apart from that, of course, foreign exchange experience in itself is extremely fun. I traveled to approximately 12 countries during this period. I was living with a few of my friends. I'm still in touch with a lot of friends from different countries. So, you know, the kind of, again, networking, kind of different friends you make, it's something that will help you throughout, not just for those 3 years, but anyway, like any time. I couple of days back, I wrote to my EM Lyon University professor for something, and I was studying in France, EM Lyon is in France, and she was a visiting professor from Italy, and I'm still in touch with her. We are still talking about things that are probably exciting for us. So, you know, the kind of people you get to talk to, the kind of exposure it has, it adds a lot of value to you as an individual. And of course, there's the traveling, the parties, all of it is extremely fun because you're not there with your family, you're there with your friends. You, for the first time probably in your life, because you join IPM after 12th standard, for the first time in your life, you enjoy that sort of liberty of being in a completely different country with unknown people. But I think IPM also trains you a lot to handle that liberty responsibly. So yes, foreign exchange, I don't think I need to say a lot more about it. This is anyway something very exciting for students. So next slide, please. Yes, talking about placements. Now, this is a very controversial topic, all right, and I don't really want to preach IPM here. Because even if it is proclaimed as a course to be at par with PGPs in terms of placements, there is a certain level of bias, which I'm already giving a disclaimer of. Having said that, I don't think it is a right parameter to compare IPM placements with the PGP counterparts. Because please appreciate the fact that the PGP students who come through CAT after 3 years, a lot of them have a certain level of work experience. Most of them have had a longer undergraduation period or have taken a drop after that. So they also come with a certain level of experience, firstly. Secondly, the PGP program has a really long legacy as compared to IPM. So the first batch of IPM graduated in 2016. And that's a lot of difference between PGP and IPM. So we also have to understand that the industry will take its own sweet time to accept IPM as a course and to offer equal packages. But there are a lot of companies that have equal opportunity for both IPM and PGP batches, but there are also some companies that open only for PGP batches. But the good part is there are also some companies that open only for IPM batches. So we are slowly progressing towards equality. And so here, as it is mentioned that the average salary was ₹20.79 lakhs. This is for the overall batch. I think the average salary for IPM was around 19 or 18 lakhs. Now, so this difference of 2 lakhs, I would leave it up to you to decide whether it's a significant difference for you and to compare it not with a PGP program, but to compare it with what are the options you have right now. Because I was in your place a few years back, and I completely understand that placements are one of the most important things that help you decide a college. But here, the wrong parameter would be to compare these numbers with your PGP counterparts, but rather you should try and compare it with what you might get if you join any other undergrad course. For example, when I got into NLUD, I compared the IPM packages with the NLUD packages. But placement was not a very important parameter for me, because once you realize that you have gotten through some colleges like NLUD and IIM Indore, placements are really not a thing that you should be concerned about at that point, because you really would be sorted that way. Placement, you will get through something or the other. If you're getting into a program like that, if you're getting through some 120 odd students from around 20,000 applicants, which calculates to 0.006 from 1,000. So this is six in a 1,000 students. So if you can crack that, you definitely have it in you to land a good placement. And the companies know it. So even though, so you have the numbers in front of you. So you're comparing a program that is around 5 years old to a program which is 20 years old, and the difference in the average salary is just 2 lakhs. So I don't think I need to say a lot more on that. And there are all of the seniors that I'm in touch with who graduated in 2016 are doing extremely well in their lives, are earning really lucrative salaries that I obviously look forward to earning a couple of years down the line, and are pretty much doing extremely well financially. So I don't think placements would ever be a reason for you to not opt for this course. Next slide, sir, please. Yes, so apart from all those serious learning, academics, and placements, there are a lot of extracurriculars activities that keep on happening in the campus that I was actively a part of. I'm still actively a part of those activities. So there are a lot of, there's a student activity council at undergraduate level. And there are a lot of different committees, clubs for people in IPM. So there is entrepreneurship club for people who want to pursue entrepreneurship. There's creativity club, there's literary, so the literary club, people who are into reading, there's dance club, there's music club. So all of these clubs, and coupled with the kind of peer group that you have here, there's a lot more opportunity for growth. Because one thing that I've realized in IPM is that the kind of people you're studying with, more than the lectures, the kind of people you're studying with, your peer group makes a lot of difference. So the off the classroom learning that happens, that makes a lot of difference to you as an individual. And even in the learning, even in the activities, you learn so much when you're a part of the fest. You're managing a crowd of say 500,000 students on campus. You're running from one place to other to just, you know, you're the real crisis management that people talk about. A lot of that happens on campus. So there's a lot of practical learning that you get through these activities, through these fests, by being a part of these committees and clubs. So next slide, please. Yeah, so IIM Indore campus is already talked about a lot for its aesthetics and the beauty that the campus has. You can Google pictures of it. I've just added one picture here. It has a really, really good atmosphere and good infrastructure for all the sports enthusiasts out there, all the fitness enthusiasts out there. So we have two really, really nice gyms. We have an Olympic-sized swimming pool, two basketball courts, a really big cricket stadium, multiple badminton courts. So we have, there's all the arrangements for anyone who wants to follow any sport. There's a squash court. There's also, apart from all the, talking about the infrastructure, apart from sports, there's also a sauna bath area. So you know, the institute has been trying its best to help you focus on your learning and it takes care of everything else, to just pamper you with everything else and help you focus on your learning and your experience in the campus. So next slide, please. Yes, so talking about what might be the most relevant action for you right now, the application form for IPM 2020 has already been closed. So I'll just run you through the IPM AT and VAT PI. And the kind of strategies that help me crack these components. But again, so, see, I've always, no matter where I've talked to and what kind of students I've talked to, I've always said that your test prep strategy and your test taking strategies, which are two different things, should always be your own. You should never try and copy anyone else's strategy because it worked for them. There is something that worked for me might or might not work for you. So always, always try to find out your strategy, what works well for you. And I think this is one area where your coaching center would help you a lot. So especially the mock test, the mock analysis, as Shweta ma'am mentioned, these things really help you a lot in deciding what kind of test strategy that you're going to take in your final attempt. How are you going to prepare for your exams? What kind of test preparation strategy will work for you? Where do you stand among your peers? So all of these areas are where coaching centers play a really important role. And there are a few people who crack these exams without coaching preparation. But personally speaking, I don't think I would have been able to do it without the help of any coaching institute. So I think coaching institutes play a really important role in not only helping you decide what kind of strategy works well for you, but also giving you an idea of where do you stand among your peers. Because imagine this, you're preparing in your own silo. You have no clue how competitive is the atmosphere around, where do you stand, what is your rank. Once you enroll in a coaching institute, after the mocks, after you get your ranks, you know, you get a sort of reality check that, okay, boss, I thought I'm doing really well, but I'm probably not. So, you know, those kind of reality checks. And then you have the analysis also that, okay, these are the weak areas and these are the strong areas. So that is where I can focus on. The IPM aptitude test, I will elaborate on the particular sections of the test in the next slide. The test basically tests your logical reasoning proficiency, your English, your mathematics. So your aptitude, logical reasoning, English, mathematics, I think these subjects are a part of almost all of the competitive exams. So again, this brings me back to the fact that if you're preparing for a competitive exam, you're not preparing for only that exam. So for example, I was preparing for CLAT, but I was preparing for all of these subjects. So I never had it in my mind that, okay, since I'm preparing for CLAT, I'm only allowed to join law colleges. Because you're sort of preparing for all of these subjects and not the undergraduate degree that you're going to take. So all of the competitive exams, they have these major subjects that have a lot of weightage in most of the competitive exams. The VAT PI, again, since this is an undergraduate level course, they do not expect you to know a lot in your personal interview. So all they expect from you is you know a lot about whatever you've studied. You're fairly proficient with your academics, whatever you had till 12, and you have an ability to learn. So that's all that they demand from you in the personal interview section. So next slide, please. So the application criteria for IPM is that candidates should have been born on or after August 1, 2000. So that was for this year. It would be different for the subsequent years. I've just put down the eligibility criteria for this year. Candidates should have passed standard 12th examination or equivalent. They should have had minimum 60% in these examinations, and that differs for different categories of reservation. So next slide, please. Yes, so coming to the IPM aptitude test, which plays the most important role in your entire selection procedure, please have a very clear idea that this is something that can single-handedly determine your entry into the college. So the first section is quantitative ability, which is multiple choice question. there are 4 marks for every questions and one negative mark for every wrong answer. Straightforward, 40 questions, 40 minutes. This section during my year and as of what I've talked to juniors in the subsequent years has a lot of questions from your NCERT topics, but not of NCERT level. So this is again one area where your coaching center would help you a lot, because see, for example, a topic like ratio and proportion or time, work and distance, all of these topics we are aware of. We have studied these topics, but the kind of questions asked in extremely competitive exams like IPM, the way they ask questions from these topics is completely different. So, you know, there's that area again. Once you enroll in a coaching institute, you practice certain questions. You get the hang of the kind of questions that can be asked in the exam. So this particular area, quantitative ability, officially it is said that till 10th class, whatever maths topics you've studied, whatever topics are generally covered in all other competitive exams. But personally speaking, I would advise the aspirants to also go through subjects of +2. So I think something like differentiation, basic logs. So all of these things, there might have been different ways of solving the questions that are asked from these topics. But just because you're aware of these topics, it helps you solve the questions faster and better. So maybe those questions are not from these topics, but probably some elementary topic. But just the awareness of these particular topics helps you a lot in solving the question paper, approaching the questions. You know, one of the most important thing that works in your favor in IPM aptitude test is recognizing the question from the first read and being able to decide whether you're going to attempt that question or not. So one very important advice I would like to give all the aspirants here is that speed is one of the most important things that can determine your score in the aptitude test. So you have to look at the question and decide whether you're going to attempt that question or not. So you have to have that level of preparation that you, by looking at the question, by reading it in one go, you can understand, okay, this is something that I'll be able to solve. This is something that I can invest some time on, or this is something that will take a lot of my time. I might be able to solve it, but it will take me 5 minutes, which I can utilize for other questions. I can probably solve 3 more questions in those 5 minutes. So in the quantitative ability section, don't aim to solve all the questions. Aim to solve all the easier questions first. And remember, always there will always be a mix of some easy questions, some moderate questions, some tough questions. So use your time very, very judiciously. Tackle the easy questions first. Realize that, you know, in all of the competitive exams, your psychological, your mindset also helps you a lot. So if you solve the easy questions first, it gives you a sort of sense that, okay, I can do this. Okay, this is something that is doable for me. I'm able to solve questions. So if you start with the easy questions, start with your strengths, it gives you a sort of, you become a little more calm, which is very important while attempting a competitive exams. You become a little more calm. You can approach the test with a lot of more positivity. So this is another strategy that I always kept in mind, that I will always tackle my strengths first. Again, there are a lot of students who like to get rid of their weak areas first. So they like to skim through their weak through the tough questions first and then tackle the easier ones. I personally always believe that it has always worked for me that I start with the easier questions first. And, you know, just before starting out with solving all the questions, just take a little time to skim through the questions. So, you know, you have an idea of what are the questions like, so that you don't regret that in giving time to this difficult question, there was a very easy question at the end of the question paper that I didn't get time to attempt at all. So just skim through all of the questions very quickly so that you also have an idea that, okay, these are the questions that I want to attempt first, and you accordingly attempt those questions. So having an idea of what the overall questions look like before actually solving any question is highly advisable from my side. Again, do not just go for a lot of attempts. That would never work for you in the quantitative ability section. One, because you do not have the time to solve all the questions perfectly. Second, in the pursuit of solving a lot of questions that you think, okay, ye to mujhe challenge kar raha hai ye question, ab to main ye solve karke hi aage badhunga. You can try that in your mocks. Please don't try that in your final competitive exam, because that's not how things work. If you think some question is challenging you a lot, because see, personally, as an individual, I used to do that a lot in my preparation. कि मुझे कोई भी डिफिकल्ट क्वेश्चन लगता था, सो आई यूज टू बी लाइक नो आई एम नॉट लीविंग दिस क्वेश्चन हियर, आई एम गोइंग टू सॉल्व दिस क्वेश्चन एंड देन मूव अहेड. बट दैट्स नॉट हाउ थिंग्स वुड वर्क इन द फाइनल कॉम्पिटिटिव एग्जाम. सो जस्ट हैव अ गुड आइडिया ऑफ व्हाट द क्वेश्चंस लुक लाइक. अटेम्प्ट द इजियर क्वेश्चंस फर्स्ट, देन इफ यू हैव टाइम यू कैन गो ऑन टू अटेम्प्ट द मोर डिफिकल्ट क्वेश्चंस. देन कम्स क्वांटिटेटिव एबिलिटी शॉर्ट आंसर्स. सो दीस क्वेश्चंस, these are the questions where you have a certain space to type your answers. Unlike the first section, you will not get to choose from different options. You will have to type in your answer here. So there is no negative marking in this particular section. So obviously it is advisable to attempt all questions, even though you have no idea at all about what the answer would look like. Even if the answer looks like something 20 and you are getting something like 0.4, you should write that, because you have nothing to lose, right, in this section. So always attempt all of these questions. Try to attempt it a little faster. Verbal ability section. So this section again has MCQ, negative 1 mark for each wrong answer, 40 questions, 40 minutes. I personally think that I got through the aptitude test because of this section alone. I attempted all 40 questions and I was pretty sure of having a decent accuracy. I would get to that question, Tejas. I will come back to that question. This section, it's very, if you've studied English throughout your school curriculum, this is a very easy section to crack. It has pretty basic English questions that are asked in all other competitive exams. So not like they're looking for someone who has a really fancy vocabulary, who knows all the big words of English. They're not looking for another Shashi Tharoor. They're just looking for a person who's good at comprehending stuff and can easily understand and accordingly approach questions. So there are a couple of questions on vocabulary and synonyms, antonyms, all of those regular competitive exams questions, but they're not really difficult. So this section especially, I would, from the preparation point of view, spend a lot of time on quantitative ability. If you think English is a weak section, then you need to spend a lot of time on verbal ability. Otherwise, I don't think you need to invest a lot of time in this section. Moving ahead, sir, if you have any other preparation related questions, we can take it up in the question answer round. VAT again does not really aim to test you on how good are you with English language. Not at all. It just aims to see that whether you can form your opinions well, whether you can put those opinions across in a certain manner. So for VAT, there's this certain structure that you can follow that is also advised in our English boards in 12th standard, which is an introduction, body and conclusion. So as a lot of our professors, and these are the people who judge your VAT, right? So as a lot of our professors say, you should always start with what you're going to tell me. So the structure is tell me what you're going to tell me. The next few paragraphs are you telling me. And the conclusion is, tell me what you just told me. So you get the hang of it, right? First, you introduce the topic. Next few paragraphs, you elaborate on the topic. The last paragraph, you conclude. You just pick some main points and say that, okay, this is what I've just told you. And this is what my opinion is. So that is the structure. More than the language, the structure and the ability to form opinion is what is tested in the written ability test. The personal interview, a lot of the a major part of your personal interview is going to be about your academics. So for example, I had commerce with maths in my 12th standard. I entered the interview room. I was asked, what is your strength? And I said, economics. So straight away, I was just given a paper and a pen. And it felt like I'm being subject to another aptitude test, because there was nothing. There was no question on why should we choose you. There was no question. You know, a lot of people say that tell me about yourself is how all interviews begin. But that was certainly not the case in my interview. So first thing, do not ever have an expectation of, okay, this is how my interview is going to go. Because you literally never have any clue that, okay, this is how it's going to go. So be open to anything that can come your way. They can throw any questions to you and be prepared for that. Hello? Am I audible now?
Yes, you are audible.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I just got a private message saying I'm not audible. Okay. Guys, if I'm not audible, please write it on the main chat. I get a little confused like that. Okay, so for the personal interview, I'll run you through my personal interview. I was just asked, what is your strength, as I mentioned. Then I mentioned it's economics. And then they made sure that I come out of the interview room thinking that it's really not my strength, because they completely grilled me on economics. You cannot expect any sort of mercy from the interview from the panelists just because you're a 12th pass out, 12th kid. Just because you think you are a kid and you should be pampered that way, you can never expect any sort of mercy from the panelists. So I was grilled a lot on what I mentioned as my strength that I really didn't agree with after coming out of the interview room. So they gave me a pen and paper, and for whoever has studied economics here or is going to study economics, we have the basic demand and supply graphs, right? So they asked me to draw a basic demand supply graph. I drew that. Then they started with a lot of variations. They gave me a lot of situations that, okay, now assume that this is the case. How will this graph change? Now assume there's this customer, there's this consumer, and this is the situation that they're facing. How will the graph look like now? So, you know, all of these things you're not really taught in your academics, in your 11, 12. But those are also not really things that you cannot do. You just have to think a little. And of course, I didn't know answer to a lot of questions. So one thing that you should always practice is be very honest about what you know and what you don't know. So, you know, this is very funny, but I still remember as most part of my interview being, sorry, ma'am, I don't know. So the professor who was questioning me on economics was a lady, and a lot of my interview answers were, sorry, ma'am, I don't know. But so that professor, I'm very well in touch with that professor now. She remembers that she took my interview. After I got into the college, I asked her, why did she choose me in spite of me answering, sorry, ma'am, I don't know, to so many of the questions. So she told me that we're not looking for someone who already knows the answer to a lot of things. We're looking for someone who displays an ability to learn. So even though I was saying I don't know, that's not what my first answer was. Whenever she gave me a situation to draw on the graph, I was trying, okay? So I was trying, and after trying a few things, I wasn't able to arrive at an answer. Then I used to tell them that, sorry, I'm not able to arrive at an answer. And then I just didn't leave it there. I asked them that, can you please let me know what the answer is? So they sort of saw that I'm someone who can learn after getting some hints from the... So in the interview also, when you're not able to solve something, they try to drop certain hints. And if you can catch on them and accordingly incorporate in your solution, so those are pretty useful hints. You can use them to arrive at an answer. So whenever I said, sorry, ma'am, I'm not able to arrive at an answer, she used to help me with certain hints, which then helped me to give her the final answer. So that is what she told me, that we're not the professor who was a panelist who still takes interviews. So she told me that we're not looking for people who already know everything. We're looking for someone who can learn. And secondly, who is honest about accepting that they do not know. because there will always be some aspirants in the interview who will think that they know a lot, and even if they don't know a question, they will try to fool the panelist in the sense that they will try to just beat around the bush in some sense. Now understand that the person who is marking you on the other side of the table is way more experienced than you, is way smarter. No matter how smart you think you are, that person is way smarter. So they'll not even take seconds to, you know, decide whether you're smart enough for the course or not. So never ever try to fool the panelists. Third important tip will be really well versed with your background. So my address, I live in the BHEL township. So one of the questions that the panelists asked me, that you mentioned your address here mentions that you live in the BHEL township. Can you tell me one of the customers of BHEL? So, you know, any question from your background, they can ask you your hobbies. If you mention basketball, they can ask you, they can ask you anything from the leagues. They can ask you recent standings of the various leagues. They can ask you about any player, your favorite player. If you say you are into reading, this is another one of the biggest mistakes I've seen a lot of people making, that they're not really into reading, but just because they've read like two novels, they mention that reading is my hobby. And this one question is the easiest for the interviewer to pick you on. Like, this is the easiest to catch. If you please be very aware of the fact that if you mention reading as one of your hobbies, you're actually practicing it. It's don't just say it in the interview because you do not have any other hobbies. And before the interview, just think, there is definitely something that you've liked doing. I have also seen a lot of people struggling with deciding what their hobby is. So I've always told this to people, there's always something that you like doing. So one of my friends who really likes to play a certain video game, he mentioned that is his hobby, that okay, my hobby is playing this game. And he was questioned on who's the developer of the game. And since he played that game a lot, he knew who's the developer. So, you know, questions, whatever you mention, any word that you're mentioning, be prepared to have a certain question, interrogative question being asked on that. So be very well-versed with what you mention as your hobby, what your background is. If you say your father is a businessman, what business he does, have a good enough understanding of whatever is going around you. For example, your city. Where do you come from? What is your city like? What is it known for? All of these things you should be really well prepared with. I think we've come to the end of this presentation. Yeah, any questions? You can please mention the questions in the public chat. Otherwise, I get a little confused. Are there any questions? You can unmute yourself and ask the questions. Okay. The distribution of marks for entrance exams and interviews, as far as I remember, the weightage keeps on changing every year. But as far as I remember, it's 60% for the aptitude test, 10% for the written ability test, and 30% for the interview. Okay, minimum score. We are not, the scores of the applicants are not revealed. But I would say that if the aptitude test, say, is of 400 marks, then something around 270 would be a safe score. So you can accordingly manage your attempts with the accuracy percentage you're keeping in mind.
Anish has asked a one personal question. Can I say?
Yes, sir, please.
A hostel facility. So it's a residential program. So yeah, you can answer.
Yeah, and so the first 3 years, unfortunately, the girls had a triple sharing room, but the boys had a single room for 2 out of the first 3 years. So yeah, they had that luxury because of the sheer number of boys that come in the program, the rooms that were already there were not enough to accommodate all of the IPM students. So the boys from my batch luckily got the opportunity to stay in single rooms, but by default, IPM students, both boys and girls, get pretty, pretty decent hostels. There's a triple sharing, attached washroom. And there's also this wash area, there's a balcony. There are pretty lavish hostels. is 12th commerce plus maths necessary to get into IPM? No, not at all, Rohit. There, the majority of students in all of the IPM batches are from science background. Do you mean to ask that do we need to have maths compulsorily along with commerce? Okay. So no, there is no compulsion like that. In fact, I had, there are a couple of students in my batch who did not have maths as their option subjects. One, in fact, did not even have commerce as his core subject. He was from arts background. So if you really have that acumen, that aptitude, you're good to go. You do not need to have maths after. Would I recommend taking maths? Definitely. I think maths really helped me a lot with the aptitude test. I just finished my 10th standard and I'm taking commerce with IP and I want to go for CA. So will taking IPM help me? I don't know what Anshika. Okay. So Anshika, I'm not sure what you mean here, because do you want to go for CA after taking IPM or you want to pursue it along with IPM? Or just attempt IPM and go for CA anyway?
Can I take this question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Definitely.
See, Anshika, CA is altogether a different course. IPM, you can understand, it's a different course. So practically going for both the courses simultaneously is not possible. But yes, you can join IPM and there you can prepare for CA, Chartered Accountants, because Chartered Accountants require, after 12, there is a entrance exam. You might be knowing this. So first you need to go for IPM. And probably there onwards, you can move to CA or CS or whatever the course you want. But parallelly, initially, it would be very difficult because IPM has altogether different syllabus and CA is altogether different syllabus. Am I correct, Anusha?
Yes, sir. And just seconding your opinion, IPM in itself, as I mentioned, is a very, very demanding course.
Yes.
So I'm not sure whether you'll get the sort of time that you're required to do a CA, from my understanding, because the friends that I have who are pursuing CA are not even doing regular BCom. They've taken some dummy college. So if that's the amount of time that CA demands from you, I would personally not advise to go for IPM. What? Oh, your time, what was the girls-boy ratio? This is a very interesting question, Anish. I'm intrigued about what are your motivations for asking this question, but it's around there are 40% girls and 60% boys. What is the procedure for career counseling?
That we will discuss. Keshav, we will let you know how to for career counseling. That I will answer.
How is the atmosphere in campus like? It's extremely. The campus, from the infrastructure sense, it's extremely green. So there's always something or the other happening in the campus. So it's very full of life in that sense. Fondly, IIM Indore is called as the campus that never sleeps. So there has never been a time whenever I've walked out of my hostel at 3 a.m., 4 a.m. in the morning, 2 a.m., I've always found someone or the other roaming around, studying in the open. So it's very lively in that sense. Is it compulsory or necessary to do PGP course? Yeah, good question, Tejas. So yeah, I almost forgot to talk about this. Thanks for reminding me. No, it's not compulsory. In fact, a lot of people say that IPM students might not be as intelligent as the people who join PGP after giving CAT. And I feel really proud to say that a lot of IPM students have been defying that over the years. So recently, from my batchmates, the exit option after 3 years of initial undergraduation was made available from my batch onwards. So very few people gave CAT in my batch. From that also, one person went to IMB, one person joined FMS, one person joined XLRI. So if you think that the other IIMs or other MBA institutes are something that you would want to go for, you can do that after IPM also. There's no bar like that. In fact, at least three of my juniors now gave CAT and are joining IIM Bangalore. One of them is joining IIM Ahmedabad. a couple of them are joining FMS, a couple of them are joining IIM Calcutta. So yes, there's no bar. You can always go for CAT if you think you can crack it.
I think that's it. Shweta ma'am, it's over to you.
Thank you, Anisha ma'am, for giving an insight about IPM 80. I hope your personal experience that you have shared during this session is really going to help our students. And further, if you have any queries, any questions, sir, can you please show the slide where we have our number?
Okay, we can send it forward.
Yeah, please note down the number. It is 9022994507. So you can contact on this number. As I've already mentioned, we are open for the online counseling also. And if you wanted to visit our center is located at Ramnagar.
Anisha, personally, it was a fantastic session. I've been to IIM Indore way back, I think 2004, when it was only constructed. It was one of the best campuses that we have. And I can see it is also delivering one of the best students in the country. Thank you so much for being a part of Vikalp Academy here. I'm pretty sure students have understood the many things about it. Thank you so much, Anusha.
Thank you for having me, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anusha. That is all for the day. I think anyone, any query you wanted to ask us, please feel free to ask. No. Okay. So thank you so much, guys, for being a part of this wonderful session. And we will be in touch with you for further counselings and other things. Shweta ma'am will be coordinating. Thank you. So I'm ending the meeting, ma'am.